On behalf of Bloomberg, welcome to our special webinar on Australia Treasury Bonds. My name is James Bell, Head of Bloomberg's Financial Products Business for the Oceania region. To begin, I would first like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the lands where we work and live. We celebrate the diversity of Aboriginal peoples and their ongoing culture and connection to the lands and waters of New South Wales. We pay our respects to elders past, present and emerging and acknowledge the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people that contributed to the development of this resource. We have a great panel of speakers joining us today, and like you, I'm interested to hear how the introduction of the five-year Treasury bond is expected to provide the market with more liquidity, transparency and trading opportunities. Launching in late November, the new five-year Treasury bond future bridges the gap between the 3 and 10 year bond future by providing an additional and useful liquidity point and hedging tool for investors. In this environment of economic uncertainty, additional risk management tools like this can be very useful, but what benefits does it bring? Here to help us answer this and other related questions are speakers from the ASX, the Australian Office of Financial Management and ANZ. Moderated by our own fixed income market specialist, Nick Burrough, our panel today brings a range of expert views, which I'm sure will make for a lively and insightful discussion. Thank you so much for joining us today. Stay safe and please enjoy the event.
Thank you very much, James. Before I introduce the panel, just a bit of housekeeping. If you could adjust your screen size and volume for the best experience, and please use the software to ask questions throughout. I will try and drop them into the main panel discussion, but we will have a dedicated Q&A section at the end. Now, today's panel is about as strong as it gets in a fixed income discussion, I would say. We have Helen Lofthouse, who is the Executive General Manager for Derivatives and OTC Markets at ASX. Helen's worked at Tier 1 investment banks in London and is now in Sydney. Brad Parry, Head of Portfolio Strategy Research at AOFM, and previously Head of Funding and Liquidity. So you don't get any more directly related to this bond future than that job. And Rakesh Jampala, Head of Aussie and New Zealand Fixed Income Trading at ANZ, which is, he may seem calm right now, that is a big job that carries a lot of risk at times. So hats off to you there. But my first point here would be, I'd like to ask Helen Lofthouse for an update and to kind of tell us how we got to this stage and why we're here today.
Great, thank you very much, Nick. And first I'd like to start by saying thank you for inviting me for today. I'm delighted to be here. This is a really important new product for the whole of the Australian market. So I'm very pleased to be doing this event and with a panel who have so much experience and great insights into the market. We think it's really important to add this five-year bond futures contract now. Australian government bond issuance is obviously scaling up significantly. And at the same time, the RBA has committed to keeping Australia's three-year government bond yield at 25 basis points for the foreseeable future. And that's reduced volatility at the three-year point. There's already around $230 billion of Australian government bonds on issue in between the three-year and the 10-year bond futures baskets, and there's plenty more to come. So hedging in the mid-curve is already something that's very important for many market participants. We'd already contemplated introducing a five-year Treasury bond future, and quite a number of customers had expressed an interest in having that product available. The timing, though, has been brought forward by today's unique market conditions. So as more and more bonds sit between those 3 and 10 year bond baskets, and I'm sure Brad will be talking today about AOFM's expectations in that area, the yield curve control means that the 3 year bond future may no longer be quite as effective a hedge for those longer dated exposures. So we think that introducing this 5 year bond future will give a really effective and efficient hedge for those midpoint, mid-curve risks. And I think one of the other interesting things is that it'll introduce some new trading opportunities as well. So with the threes, fives and the fives, tens spreads that we're introducing, and the contract aligns well with offshore futures markets. So there's some really interesting global relative value trading opportunities there. So all in all, we think that the combination of the current market conditions and the market maker support that we're introducing is really going to help to build liquidity and open interest very quickly. And that contract will have a great chance of really long-term success and bringing an extra point of liquidity and hedging for the Australian market.
That you mentioned there. So when I initially heard there was a five-year bond future, I assumed it was in response to COVID extra bond issuance, but you're actually saying this was in the plan prior to 2020.
Yeah, and it's certainly something a number of customers had expressed an interest in, not least because of how well that would align with overseas bond futures contracts and the trading opportunities there. I think that, as I say, the thing that's changed is that with market conditions, there's a real need for it. And that hedge that people once would have used of just using a mixture of threes and tens to hedge those in between positions, because of the yield curve control, it potentially just doesn't work so well. So that gives us a real impetus and the opportunity to really build liquidity fast in a new contract. And that's very important for everyone who wants to use it.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I've got some more questions for you later, but I'm just going to ask Brad for an update from the AOFM side before we start the main panel discussion. If you could update us, please, Brad.
Sure. Thanks, Nick, and thanks for organising this session. So last year, the government's budget had returned to balance and we were forecasting surpluses for the years ahead. But obviously the pandemic and the government's response to the pandemic have changed all that. And so the AOFM's funding task has changed accordingly. For the 2020-21 financial year, we're now expecting $240 billion of Treasury bond issuance. We've front-loaded the issuance program, so we've already issued 130 of that 240 billion, and so far that issuance has been absorbed smoothly, which we think is a great reflection on the Australian government securities market, and is obviously helpful to us. We've had a number of syndications that we've held that have helped us to achieve that $130 billion. I think we've got a slide here. We've had strong demand from a diverse group of investors at each of these syndications, which has been really pleasing. One thing you'll notice there is that we've syndicated bonds in the 4, 5, and 6 year part of the yield curve. This is not an area that we've issued into very heavily over the last few years. But has been very helpful in us achieving the issuance volumes that we've needed to achieve so far this year. In particular, the NOV 25 bond and the September 26 bond, we issued with the five-year futures contracts in mind, and we made sure that we'd issued both of those bonds in time so that they were available for the first futures baskets when they were announced. And so we're quite pleased this week to see that both of those bonds had found their way into the baskets for the first two expiries. So that's that from us. And the next update from us on our issuance program will be in January.
Thanks, Brad. And if I may say, if anyone has ever told you you have an important job, it just got a lot more important. So good luck with all of your efforts for everybody going forwards from here. Now, my first question here was really back to Helen on the product side. So would users of ASX products, can we expect that we can trade curve products in the way that people generically talk about the curve as being threes, tens? Going forwards, every possible permutation of curve trading between threes, fives, tens, and 30s will be available?
Sure, we're listing new threes, fives, spread and a 5-10 spread initially, and we'll see how those goes, but we'll obviously be listening to customers and happy to consider demand for any other spread contracts that they'd like to see. But we think the 3-5 and the 5-10 is going to be very important, and obviously the 3-10s spread, the existing one, will also remain and be usable for clients as well. So plenty of spread opportunities there, I think, that people will be able to use.
Cool. And I looked through the list, we've got a great sign up for today and a lot of people from across ASPAC. If you were in any doubt, Australian ASX bond futures are unique in terms of they actually trade on yield. So it's a very easy exchange in order to trade curve. And I actually kind of contrast to some of the offshore markets. I was going to ask Rakesh, do you see like the offshore markets that trade price in the five-year area and stuff, you think that the volume from five-year contracts will be a lot driven by maybe spread trades across macro trading, intra-currency?
Yes, certainly they will. I mean, when we think about what are the two, let's start with the three-year. One of the reasons why the three-year future is one of the top 10 liquid interest rate contracts in the world and so successful over a number of years is it really fulfills the two primary purposes of a futures contract, hedging and for speculative purposes. And I think that's the issue now we have with yield curve control. As a speculative tool, its deployability is lessened. And even for hedging purposes, if you think about a government bond book, to the extent that it buys physical bonds, the three-year future is no longer a perfect hedging tool. And that's what the five-year future does. It fills that gap quite nicely. It's the center of all core activity in the Australian fixed income market. So I think it's got all the tools for being successful very quickly.
Yeah, I think it kind of says that, you know, not always duration hedging is the best approach. There's a certain amount of correlation in there, which this can help with. Helen, one of the questions for us is, what have you done in order for liquidity here? How are you going to establish liquidity early on? And is there anything that you've done to put a plan in place for that?
Yeah, absolutely. We are going to have support in both the day and the night session from several market makers right from the off, and that's great. And a big thank you to those market makers who are really stepping behind the contract and making sure that it sets off with some really good liquidity throughout the sessions to start with. We think it's also really important that people can easily trade it for EFPs. So I'm pleased to say that the bond EFPs are going to be available from the offset on several trading platforms, and a large number of the bond desks have already confirmed that they are going to be offering bond EFP pricing for their customers right away. And then on the swap side, so swap EFTs as well, I think will be important. And the AFMA Swap Committee is in the process of changing their conventions so that the underlying bond and swap tenors are a benchmark there to the five-year bond futures contract for that. So, you know, there's been a lot of interest. Clearly, this is an important contract. I think the market need for it is clear to everyone. So, you know, I hear consistently both from our clients directly and then from our trading, our execution and clearing brokers, that they're just seeing a lot of demand for this contract. So I think with the combination of the market maker support, the EFP pricing, and just a lot of client demand for that point in the curve, it should have a really strong start.
Cool. I think that kind of segues really to Rakesh's field, because when we think about bond EFP, by definition, all longer bonds, at some point they're going to stop referencing tens and they will move to threes. And so there's a natural situation where you could roll into the fives and then to the threes. But OTC derivatives, Rakesh, are different in terms of, you know, inertia around market conventions. As a European coming down there to Australia, like many others, we look at conventions and say, how did it end up there? Do you believe that the OTC markets will easily adopt this for EFP reference?
Yeah, I do. And a bit of background for you, Nick, and for our viewers. We have a few idiosyncrasies with our derivatives market, to the extent that, for example, a five-year swap spread, or an EFP as we like to call it, is actually referenced off the three-year future. Similarly, the seven-year EFP is off the 10-year future. So every time you enact one of these EFPs or swap spread trades, you actually have immediate curvature. So the status quo is post-November. The swap market, as I understand it, plan to sit back, assess the introduction of the five-year future, and they'll see probably by March as to when they actually change the five-year to trade off the five-year future. My own expectation is they'll probably do it earlier. If my own view on how liquid and active the five-year future proves close to being correct, I anticipate we get there earlier. I mean, why would you, as a swap trader, do a five-year FP referenced off the three-year future and have curvature when you can go straight off the five-year future?
Yeah, well, that's good. I mean, as a derivatives guy myself, I find that interesting. I'll watch with great interest how that pans out. But Brad, in practical terms, what will AOFM look for in helping the market with the adoption of this this five-year contract?
Sure. So we've got a long history of supporting the various Treasury bond futures contracts, even going back to a time when the government was running persistent budget surpluses and we had a very small bond market. The supporting the futures contracts was a very big part of what the focus was. And so we'll continue to support the contracts, including the new five-year contract. There are some, we see some benefits to us in the contract coming along. We think it's going to give us a bit more flexibility in our issuance decisions. To give you an idea, last financial year, we issued $128 billion in Treasury bonds, but only $1 billion was between 5 and 8 years to maturity. So far this year, we've issued a similar amount. We've issued about $130 billion in total in Treasury bonds, and $50 billion of that has been between 5 and 8 years. And a big part of that is the coming five-year contract, or we think it is. And that makes it easier for the market-making banks to warehouse stock that they take from us at tenders. And so it's easier and cheaper for them to manage the risk associated with those bonds. So we think it's going to make it easier for us to issue in that part of the curve, and we'll support that part of the curve by doing things like taking account of market conditions when we're making our regular issuance conditions. And so that looks like issuing into demand. Where there is demand for those bonds, you can expect that we'll look to issue them. And conversely, if part of the curve is struggling for a short time, then we'll avoid issuing into that part of the curve.
Yeah, no, it's a great story. You have a local exchange, the government is supportive of it, and you know, traditionally, you know, banks are looked at as being OTC providers and stuff, and we have a bank on the panel today who's going to support that contract. So financial markets are supposed to be zero-sum game, but it does feel as though everyone's pulling in the same direction. But you talked about market conditions, Brad, but Helen, could you comment on in March there was some extreme volatility, you know, ASX, how everything came together from your perspective through that period?
Sure. Look, March was a fascinating time for all of us, and not always in the best way, right? But from a futures market perspective, it was really interesting because obviously there was some real dislocation in the physical bond market. But on the futures side, although there was a lot of volatility as prices moved a lot, actually the futures contract remained very liquid with very tight bid-offer spreads available, despite all of those challenges in the OTC markets. So futures, the key bond futures contracts were consistently offered at half-tick bid-offer spreads, and that's even when those cash bond spreads were reaching 15 basis points, kind of a standard, and at times even wider than that. And I think that what you can see there is that the standardization of the futures market, and also the fact that there's just such a great scale of participation from all around the world, of all different types of customers, all of those people coming together at the same point means that the liquidity is really, is really pulled together, and that market diversity means that liquidity is still available to people, even at times of such huge volatility, when people really need to access those contracts, and they were still there and those prices were there for people to use. So that was really great to see, and I think, really was clear to everyone involved in the market just how important that liquidity and that market operation really is. An interesting observation as well was that we did see that EFPs were also very important in the March to April period. So we saw some interesting dynamics where you had investors who were selling government bonds to realize cash. So at a time when some people were having to meet margin calls or liquidate parts of portfolios as asset prices changed, they were selling sometimes the liquid government bonds as the most straightforward way to realize cash. And actually, EFPs were really an important mechanism for people to do that. So they could get really tight pricing on those asset sales by accessing the futures market liquidity and then actually being able to wind out of that futures position in their own time. And they were finding that they were getting much better pricing by doing that. So really interesting to see the interesting role of those bond EFPs in the futures market as well.
Cool. I actually have one question from the audience here, specifically around the options, the listed options. Should we expect listed options on the five-year contract? It doesn't specify whether it's the overnight or intradays or whether it's the regular expiries. Should we expect those at some stage, or is that a wait and see?
Look, I think at some stage, you know, this is obviously a major contract in the bond futures suite, and we expect it to be liquid and an important part of the curve ongoing. And therefore, I think it will make sense to add options for the 5 year. We haven't specified a date, and that's really going to depend a lot on the take up and the demand. But I certainly would expect that in due course, we'll add options to the suite of products that are available there.
Rakesh, one of the questions, which is actually for myself, is we're going to have quite a big change in fixed income markets around the end of some benchmarks offshore and stuff like that. I just wondered, do you have a view around whether, like, the benchmarking, whether is it going to be easy to persuade a whole group of interbank dealers to change the existing market? Is it something that could perhaps be adopted into the new EFO, you know, exchange for OIS swaps market in the future? Or do you think, you know, maybe it's done through the local Financial Markets Association, AFMA committee? You know, how confident are you that you can get the OTC market to adopt the benchmarking?
Yeah, good question, Nick. And I think the answer actually flows on nicely from Helen's comments. Post-March and the onset of COVID and its implications for markets, the world has changed a lot. And what we've seen really is a return to primacy of cash physical markets. It's almost a back to the future, back to the 90s. What do I mean by that? When I think about fixed income, there are broadly four parts: credit, the traditional bonds and semi-specs, and the derivatives. Basis TFF, what we'll find now is over the next number of years, almost no issuance by banks and regionals. So the universe of investable credit drops a lot. Similarly, we've seen deployment of derivatives by speculators and hedgers alike drop off. The big flip side to this is an explosion in trading of physical bonds and the issuance of them. And a bulk of that has been, Nick, in that 5 to 7 year part of the curve. So this 5 year future really fills that gap nicely, and it's perfectly placed to really be the center of the market. So coming back to your question, the speed with which OTC markets via vehicles such as AFMA and so on, I imagine it'll be quite immediate. They'll move and adapt to the market and basis how quickly this future is adopted.
Cool. And Brad, in terms of we were discussing earlier, I looked at the average duration of your fixed portfolio. It was interesting to me that it seems as though with the average duration of your portfolio, I calculated it 7.3 and you were 7.4 in your official data. The five-year bond future is actually the closest to the overall weighted average portfolio. Do you feel as though, is this a cue for you to shorten your duration on balance around issuance?
No, we won't be basing our issuance strategy around the new contract. We will, as I say, do what we can to support it by making sure that there are sufficient bonds to make up the baskets, and also that there's the right amount of volume in each of those bonds. As I say, I think what it'll do for us is just give us a bit more flexibility, give us another point in the curve that we can issue into. We focused very heavily, particularly on bonds in a 10-year futures contract and to a lesser extent a 3-year contract in recent years. So it just gives us somewhere else to go to when we're issuing quite a large program by historical standards. We've already seen, because we've already issued a lot of the 10-year bonds 5 years ago, if you like, there's already a lot of bonds out there in that part of the curve to both make up the baskets and also for people to trade against the 5-year futures contract. And we've already seen, compared to previous years, we've already seen a market increase in liquidity in the bonds that sit between the baskets, which traditionally had not been nearly as liquid as the 3 and 10 year basket bonds. We've already seen that start to pick up, so that's really encouraging. But we think that there's already plenty of bonds in that part of the curve, and as I say, to the extent that we do need more issuance, then we stand ready to do that. But we've had a long dated issuance bias for some time, and you can expect that to continue for now for the AOFM.
Look, we have got a lot of questions actually, and if we don't answer your question, we'll endeavour to get back to you. But there's one question that's a bit off topic here, and I will ask it anyway. But this is directed to Helen. Is there any plans to change the tick value of the bank bill future? So don't answer that now, but it's an interesting comment. But I wanted to mention it because futures markets are not static, and the ASX have done a lot of work around moving things. This 5-year contract is an example, but the bank bill future has gone to cash settled, which is a dynamic move. And even I would, off topic, applaud the work you've done around the rebuild of BBSW and stuff. So listing a futures contract and then sitting back and listing another one's not quite the game. It's not as static as you might think. Now, how does the possibility of QE in Australia play into the outlook for the 5-year future? I think we kind of answered that earlier, but Rakesh, have you got anything to add from previous comments on that?
Well, if any of our viewers knew exactly what the RBA was going to deliver to us next Tuesday, that'd be quite handy. You mentioned things being static, the RBA policy and how they, I guess, unleash, for want of a better term, QE. That remains to be seen, and I guess we'll all see how that plays out.
There's a few questions here I think might be difficult to answer online. One person has asked whether you can name the market makers, Helen, and I suggest we just, if you're not comfortable, hold back on that. But that's something that we can maybe take offline. But just to repeat what Helen and Rakesh both have said is, ANZ is a minimum have committed to being a market maker on this. That's all available information I have, unless anyone wants to add.
Thank you. But what I will do is make sure we cross-check with our market makers about whether they want to be named as market makers, and if they're happy and willing to do so, then we'll certainly share their names. But I want to make sure that we've authorised with all of them first of all. But obviously a big thank you to ANZ for stepping up and playing that role too.
One question here is the tick value of
Nick, I was just going to add that certainly we're proud to be a market maker here. We think the 5-year future will do very well. And look, it's my expectation, even within the first few days, that this contract will be trading in good size at a half point price right throughout. So I imagine it really picking up instantaneously from what the 3-year used to do for the market.
There's one technical question here of, do we know what the tick value will be on the future? Well, it's a well-defined contract with no ambiguity, which you can get from ASX documentation, which vendors like Bloomberg will program, and it will change contract by contract as the bond basket changes. If the question relates specifically to the next contract that's being listed, perhaps I come back to you on that, because I think Bloomberg should be a calculator of that data. It may even be on the ASX website itself. Good question from somebody around benchmarking in terms of, you know, when bonds reference, you know, the formal, there's no strict rule about when bonds roll with benchmarking, Rakesh, to the best of my knowledge. It seems to be by agreement across market makers and the market in general. The suggestion here is, you know, do you think there's an opportunity to make EFP benchmarking less ambiguous and subjective to make it very formulaic?
Sure. I mean, I think the vehicles, the mediums that we have at play now work fairly well. So both for the derivatives and bond markets in Australia, AFMA have committees, and they're comprised of sell-side participants at the banks, but also a number of buy-side participants and trading platforms, whereby they collectively agree on standards and market etiquette.
Yeah. I think from a Bloomberg perspective, we'd have a vested interest there because we like rules. We like things we can program. There's a question here that I actually asked myself when I heard about the 5 years. I think one of the really interesting things is this spread trade between Schatz, Bobbles, Bunds, Buxel in Germany and the same in notes. You know, twos, fives, tens is a pattern in those exchanges. The question here, and this might not be the way to word this to you, Helen, isn't so much will you, is it worthy of consideration that we have a 2 year rather than a 3 year future for bonds, for the symmetry with offshore?
Sure. And look, this is definitely a question that has had quite a lot of discussion so far, both at ASX and with our customers. I guess there's arguments in both directions. So I think now we've got the 5 year coming at the end of November. Clearly, the gap between the 3 and the 5 year is not huge. And at the moment, I think that's totally fine because the 3 year with yield curve control is operating in a very different fashion from the 5 year point. So both serve a very important purpose. I think as we look forward, there's really an open question there about whether it makes sense to either slightly shorten the duration of the 3 year or perhaps even in due course replace it with a 2 year. But we really need to work with all of our market participants to make sure that we fully understand how everyone's using it and what everyone wants to see in the future. There are definitely market participants who are keen to see a switch to a 2-5-10 structure because, as you say, that matches extremely well against overseas contract structures and creates some great relative value opportunities and international hedging capabilities. And there are, you know, there are some other good reasons why the 2 year contract might work well. But we also know that the 3 year contract is a really important benchmark for many of our key Australian customers. So having it as a 3 year, you know, for a part of the customer base is just extremely important. So there's a real balance of views there, and we haven't, structured that into a formal plan. So we'll be continuing to work with customers and really understand what people want for the long term. And, you know, as we get that input and develop views on that, obviously that's something that in the future we would, if there were any intention to change that contract, we would be consulting with customers in a more formal way on that. So everyone, you know, as well as doing the informal discussions, everyone would get a line of sight on that if there were actually plans in the future to switch to a 2 year. But I can certainly see that there are some compelling reasons to do so. We just need to really make sure we understand the balance of what all of our customers need from the contract.
Yeah. Look, that was actually a question asked by multiple members of the audience. So, and it kind of, like I said, it's something I'd asked myself. So it's good to know that it's something you've internally discussed and it's not a fresh idea. Look, I think we've kind of covered, I'm trying to bucket the questions into sort of groups to kind of answer them multiply. I think we are kind of done for the moment. Oh, one final question. Is there potential for a butterfly, threes, fives, tens butterfly contract? Is that something you've considered?
Look, we haven't looked at listing something like that yet. We're starting off with the 3.5s and the 5.10s, but again, we're definitely keen to hear what customers want, and if there's demand for that kind of capability, then we'd certainly look at adding it. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not even aware if that's one of the things that I think is very neat about ASX product is the fact that it's yield based, and because it's yield based, you can potentially have 3s, 5s, 10s that make sense. Executing price based 3s, 5s, 10s, I mean, I don't know how that would even work. So, as an Englishman, I hate to say it, but Australia seems to be a leader in simplicity in this field. Now, I think I'm going to call that a day on the questions here. I'll just give it a couple more seconds, perhaps, for any new questions before we cut off. That's a wrap on the Q&A, which just leaves me to say my thank yous to the panel and to the organisations themselves. So firstly, I'd like to thank Helen. I think to bring this contract at the most needed time in rapid fashion, and to think that you were thinking of it before 2020 is very cool. I'd like to thank your team as well, Dee Kirby, Neil Easton, Monique Bell, who helped us get here today. And for the other work that you're doing going on as well around financial markets, BBSW reform and modification of contracts like the bank bill. So well done, ASX, and I appreciate your contribution today. Rakesh, there is definitely no certainties in life, including trading P&L. But if nothing else, I think what you're doing, the intention is right. And a lot of talk about liquidity and transparency. And obviously banks, they want to help their customers more than ever. I hope it's a successful endeavor for you. But if nothing else, I feel as though you're doing the right thing. So well done to Rakesh and his team at ANZ. And as I said earlier to Brad, massive weight on your shoulders for the years ahead around funding the nation. Good luck with that, and I think everyone's behind you to keep the awesome respect that financial markets has for AOFM and the funding. But so thanks to you all, and hopefully, who knows, we may be here next year doing Bridging the Gap version 2, or Extending the Bridge version 2, the ASX 2-year Treasury bond. Thank you very much.